Good evening, everybody. Welcome to our Benedictine Conversations for February 2021. For those of you that have been a part of this before, you know kind of how the flow goes. For the rest of you, if this is new for you, we'll be starting in a minute with prayer. And then I will introduce our guest and we'll launch into a conversation. If at any point you have anything that you want to add or a question, certainly feel free to offer it in the chat function at the bottom of your screen, or later on in the evening, I will open it up for comments, questions, and more interaction between you, the participants, and us. So at this time, I would like to bring Sister Beverly Horn to come to join us on screen here. She'll be here shortly. And I'm going to Sister Beverly, where did we go? I hear you. Oh my. Well.
She's muted.
Are you muted, Sister Beverly? Could you? I don't even, okay, I have her. There you are. Okay, so we need your video and we know, there you are.
Okay.
So let me share the screen and Sister Beverly is going to lead us in prayer tonight.
Mm-hmm. This is a prayer for our uncertain times. Let us pray. May we who are merely inconvenienced remember those whose lives are at stake. May we who have no risk factors remember those most vulnerable. May we who have the luxury of working from home remember those who must choose between preserving their health and making their rent. May we who have the flexibility to care for our children when their schools close remember those who have no options. May we who have to cancel our trips remember those who have no safe place to go. May we who are losing our margin money in the tumult of the economic market remember those who have no margin at all. May we who settle in for a quarantine at home remember those who have no home. As fear grips our country, let us choose love. And during this time, when we may not be able to physically wrap our arms around each other, let us yet find ways to be the loving embrace of God to our neighbors. Amen.
Amen. Thank you so much, Sister Beverly. Thank you. So, tonight, I have the pleasure of introducing our guest to you, Dr. Victor Klimoski. And the name of tonight's event is The Creative Potential of Crisis, a Benedictine Perspective. So Vic comes to us from St. Paul. He had a career in educational administration. He does work now as an adult educator, as a consultant, and as a writer, offering wonderful writing workshops and retreats. And a spoiler alert, just so you know, he's going to be offering one for us, for the center, in March. So watch your email there. I first met Vic when I was working on my master's degree, I believe, at St. John's School of Theology in Collegeville, Minnesota, or it might have been even a little bit after that, where he was serving as the director of lifelong learning. my experience of Vic is that he's a masterful poet. As a person of thoughtful reflection with a keen eye and engaging wit. And most importantly for us here tonight, he is deeply formed in the Benedictine way of life. And so, Vic, I welcome you and thank you so much for being here with us tonight.
Thank you. It's my pleasure to be here, Dawn.
So I'd like to just start, Vic, if you just want to say a little bit about yourself, your background, how did you come to your embrace of the Benedictine way of life?
Like so many things in my life, I at first believed I backed into them, and then I see the hand of God and providence at work. I grew up in northeastern Wisconsin, and when I went off to college, I ended up by pure chance at St. John's University in Collegeville, Minnesota, and was there for 5 years, both finishing my college degree and then I was in a seminary for 3 more years. And then I returned to St. John's in two different periods, one for 5 years and one for my last 15 years of active work in different staff capacities at the School of Theology. So in many ways I was in the environment of St. John's, but I also had the privilege and the delight of having some wonderful Benedictine teachers. My mentor for my whole life until 2 years ago, in fact, Father Kieran Nolan was a major influence in my life. And, in a culture, there are things that, the architecture and the art and the ways and the rhythms of the life form you. So I had both a formal schooling in Benedictine spirituality and a Benedictine vision of the world, as well as the informal reinforcement that comes from being with people who know it deeply. Mm-hmm. And part of my career at St. John's, I was also the director of the Benedictine Center at St. Paul's Monastery. And so I worked closely with the community there, strongly influenced by Sister Carol Rennie and Sister Virginia Motter, who both by the examples of their lives, their corrections of me from time to time, and their instruction, the way their commentaries and their reflections taught me a lot. So it seems to me that it's sort of in my bones now. It's been 60 years since I started that journey that took me to Collegeville and in various ways back to St. John's a number of times. Mm-hmm. And so it is part of how I understand myself, how I see myself, and how I think. Mm.
Wow. Well, thank you. And I know we'll hear more about that through the evening. One of the things I'm curious about is with all the guests that we've had this year is how you're handling the pandemic. And I'm intrigued by your title, The Creative Potential of Crisis. I'm curious about your initial response in the pandemic and curious that you're here now and can say this title, The Creative Potential of Crisis, because for so many of us, the pandemic is hard enough to deal with, but to learn from it, to be creative within it. So if you could speak to sure. that a little.
First of all, I was very chastened by the opening prayer because that was my initial reaction. I complained, I was annoyed, I was inconvenienced. Mm-hmm. Things were changing in my life. We have two adult children that live here in town and they each have two boys. And so we have went through a period of figuring out whether we're going to ever see them in the flesh again. And, and so I was, it was pretty selfish. It was pretty self-centered. Nobody in my circle, my wife or family or children, obviously, have been affected with the virus itself. And so it was a matter of my inconvenience and my sense of loss. There's a point at which, while I am Eastern European by heritage, we dwell in the shadows for most of our lives. It really became oppressive. I just couldn't stay in that oh poor me thing. I worked with a fellow a long time ago on a board. It was a troubled board one time, and a midst of a meeting, he said, you know, we're much better as a board in admiring misery than doing anything about it. And I was reminded of Wayne's observation about myself, my rhetoric, and the way I was thinking. And it just happened as I was starting to come to that conversion point that Sam Rayburg at the Benedictine Center in St. Paul, who was the director, invited me to lead what we call the Great Conversations. These were quarterly gatherings of people around a topic. And he said, you can pick the topic. And I said, well, listen, let me do something around Benedict and COVID and the election and crisis and how we see, you know, how we see the darkness and the light in this darkness. So I had to design something that would invite people into a conversation in which we did not simply admire the misery, but we thought creatively about what we could do with it. And then I think that began a process of thinking about ways in which what seems to be to have nothing meritorious about it, that perhaps there is a way that we can rethink it, reposition it, restructure it, that allows us not to be the total victims of it.
Mm. Yeah. Right. That's been the critical switch through this past year. You've written the following quote. You've written that noise is the bane of contemporary society generally, and more so in this crisis, and that listening requires a posture of learning in order to cut through the noise to the cries of the heart and to what lies below our frustration and fear. So as you've made that switch and worked with these folks with this Great Conversation series, what did you hear? What are the cries of the heart that you have heard?
There are a number that that come to me immediately and that I still continue to think about. One is the loss of the myth of our invincibility. There is nothing we can't conquer. Science will set us free. We can overcome anything that happens to us as long as it doesn't take more than 3 days. And so all of a sudden people are realizing that this experience is going to be with us for a long time. And I think that loss of myth is what people talked about. The other thing that I heard as I have talked with that group in the Great Conversation and subsequently, and I can only describe it as the rip of the social fabric, is that people once they get by our spitting language about politics and all that, is the realization that we as a society were being pulled apart. But it was manifested again and again, and I hear it even now, stories where people cannot have conversations with members of their families or with friends or with neighbors because of how they vote or how they see the world. And that was more than just sort of a ideological war. And that's why the ripping is such a apt image for me. And what that does, and I suppose related to that is the decreasing amount of trust, the realization that you had to be careful and wherever you were about what you could say. You could not trust that people would give you the benefit of the doubt or to give you an opportunity to speak your truth. But in those, so I heard that part of it, and that will come as a surprise to no one. What I also heard from people, and it could be just the circle of my association and the people who work with me or participate in events that I am part of, is a recognition that we cannot do this alone. That even though there is the lament about the fracturing that's happening, that people are experiencing, there's a sort of a recommitment that this is not something that we do one by one by one by one, is that we do need to lean in towards one another. I was very pleased to hear some people talk about their renewed respect for organizations and the work that organizations do to provide a service. I mean, that was the first obvious one, but people would talk about how they or others that they know have developed a new appreciation for teachers and the educational system and the work that they have before them and what this time has driven to that, has added to that. But an appreciation for our organizations generally. We have a, you know, part of our myth of invincibility is that we are self-sufficient. And COVID has taught us that we are not self-sufficient, that we need our institutions. They need to be vital. They need support. They always need to be called to accountability, but the denigration of teachers, of political leaders, of people who are in other leadership positions simply was counterproductive. Mm. So, you know, it is a both and. It is both this lamenting of the loss that has happened to us as people, as individuals, and it's also stirring recognition of what working hand in hand and supportive of one another is possible to accomplish.
And so how does seeing those things happening, right? How does that feed into this idea of the potential of the crisis? What is the potential? What is the hope?
Well, when you come to the realization that you are not going to solve the dilemma by yourself, you do need to begin listening, paying attention, first of all, to what's happening, because it's very easy to paint a picture that is totally in black, right? It mm-hmm. is total, there's nothing to be seen. There are no points of light. And I think that people began to realize that they could stay against that dark screen, or they could begin to really see what people were doing in small ways, you know? And so there was a new alertness to that. There was even, I read something about a movement for kindness, of being actively kind. You know, it sounds like that should be a reflex that we learned at our parents' knees, but in this particular time of being very attentive of the way we can be curt with one another, the way we can be in our busyness, you know, sort of indifferent, is that there's a slowing down, some of it forced, being able to speak clearly because of the mask, but actually being more purposeful about what we have done. I think that if there's any creative potential in crisis, it is about intentionality. It is about deciding that we're going to do something. We have been for a very long time running an automatic pilot. You know, it's the program like an app that's in the background. Life goes on, we do our jobs, we have our families, we go about all the things that we go about. And now we have to be intentional if we want something to happen. And that's, you know, that's why, you know, certainly attentiveness and listening as two Benedictine values came immediately to mind in my own thinking and working with others on this, is that, you know, that if we're going to be intentional, we have to pay attention to what's happening, the positive and the negative impacts that are occurring, and that we have to listen to one another. We have to listen beyond the barriers that we create. You know, effective listening in communications theory is that we listen to what someone is saying, not what we assume they say. And it's very easy for me, you know, you can be telling me something and I draw the conclusion, this is what Dawn means, before I have any notion of what you mean. And the sort of intentional, purposeful listening that we need to have as we figure out how we're going to get back to some sort of harmonious relationship is pretty demanding. It's pretty, pretty demanding.
Intentionality. You know, I was having a conversation with some people today about this idea of coming to a conversation without prior judgments about what you're going to say or who you are or who you want to be. Where's our motivation there? Where does that come from? Because intentionality is tough.
Well, You know, I think you have to reclaim your values. What do you really value? And if you say that being in relationship with people, of being a good neighbor, of being tolerant are values, then you need to figure out how you're going to practice them when you're with someone who is so obviously wrong, right? You have to be able to say, what I'm doing with that prejudgment, with acting out of my bias, what I assume this person is like, is conflicts with what I believe are fundamental values that anchor me and give me a sense of my own integrity and authenticity as a person. So I think it, you know, maybe that is part of the creative potential of crisis, is that in a crisis, we have to decide where we're going to stand, on what do we stand. And it seems to me, part of that, of course, is our value, the values that we claim direct us, form us, and give us an orientation in life.
Yeah. Wow. I need to do Lexio on some of the thoughts you've just given us. But I'm going to come at it from another direction here and just ask you, this hasn't been a fun year. There's death, there's financial ruin, there's, you know, breakups between families, and, you know, just all sorts of things. People who have had their lives irrevocably changed in the last year. So when we talk about this sort of thing, about being intentional and moving forward with these sorts of ideas, is this pie in the sky thinking? Are we spiritualizing something that's really, really bad that's happened to the whole world?
I think there's always that danger. I think that that's... that lurks there, is that when we can't think of a solution, we put on a happy face, or we say, you know, there's some potential here that if we work hard enough, it will work. I was talking to my brother who is facing cancer, and you know, there's some dark humor that we enter into, but he was talking about something, and I said, you know, Bob, our mother would say you should offer that up to Jesus, or offer that up for the poor souls. That was her favorite thing. I broke my arm, offered up for the poor souls. The dog bit me, offered up for the poor souls. it has that sort of a ring, you know, sort of a reflexive thing. And so I think I would be very cautious about being too glib about saying about, yes, but in the midst of this, there is creative potential. I think that the conversation starts differently. You know, what's important to us? How are we going to be able to work together to help one another? How are we going to figure out ways of doing things in new ways that enable us to respond in a compassionate, just, an equitable way. Just talking about the wonders of what we can learn in a crisis is not enough. It is learning how to frame and carry on conversations that allow people to come into them wherever they are. And that means that people are gonna come in and say, I lost my grandmother. I did not have a chance to say goodbye to her. And so I can't see right now the creative potential that you're talking about, sir. And I don't think the response is to defend that there's some potential. I think the response is to talk about the loss of her grandmother. That's what paying attention is. And that's what listening is. It is knowing when you can talk about, well, what can we learn from this that can help us as individuals, as communities, as neighborhoods, as families move forward? That's an important conversation. But when someone says, I've lost my job, or I'm at home with three kids and I'm trying to do my work online and supervise their education, I'm not going to talk about creative potential. I'm going to talk about what that feels like and ways in which they, if they, you know, ways in which they are managing it and helping them to, you know, in a few instances I know of people who are doing some significant adjustment and adaptation. And when you're in the midst of it, you don't see that you're doing it. You just think that this is all chaos. And so sometimes, you know, it's being able to give people a chance to talk long enough that they can say, well, you know, this is not what I want. This is really demanding, but I've learned to do this. You know, I've learned how to structure my life and my children's lives, and we seem to be in a better place. So, you know, it really is being present to the conversation as there and not taking people too quickly, you know, to this land of light and music that I'm talking about. But I won't abandon that. I think that if I am correct and if I believe this, is that what I glean from my understanding of Benedictine spirituality and Benedictine vision of the world is that we have to work hard and do it together, not to become victims of this time, not to become victims of COVID, not become victims of the election, you know, politics, of the political situation in this country, the environmental crisis, the systemic racism that we face, but that somehow we have to be able to believe that we can move forward into that.
And you're speaking victims figuratively.
Yes.
Yes. Yeah.
Where we have no power, where we say, oh, there's nothing we can do. You know, the world's falling apart. What am I going to do? I'm just going to go into my little cave. And I don't think that's the response.
Right. Well, it's hard. It's hard. And one of the things I was reflecting on today with this idea is that that is what we're called to as people of faith, as people of the book, as followers of Christ. But this is long. This pandemic is long. I mean, I was reflecting the other day about how at the beginning, we thought it was going to be a month long, maybe two. So we sort of canceled programming for a month and then we canceled it for another month. And all of a sudden it starts to dawn on us that, wow, this is who knows how long. So, you know, you've written that, and many people have, that Benedict said that God is revealed in our everyday life. And this everyday life is, like I said, it's getting long for people. A lot of people are abandoning all sorts of cautions, which is helping the spread of the virus and all sorts of other things with so many of the other issues we've been facing. So what do we do? What do we do? How do we endure? How do we persevere?
That's a good question. Terribly unfair, but it's a good, that's a very good question, and one that doesn't have an easy answer. If I were to take a crack at channeling Benedict, I think that he probably would offer three pieces of advice. One is to hearken to the gospel. And it's the center of the rule. It's the center of his vision of the life, of life. Clearly related to that is to practice virtue as much as you can, wherever you can. Mm-hmm. And the third is to draw close. It's the idea of community, of drawing close. One thing, social isolation, is that it accents isolation. It accents not gathering and not being in a conversation and not, you know, being solicitous and not being spontaneous. Everything has to be so planned. You got to be masked up, and how far are you? How close are you? And all of that. And so, when I say draw close, I think what Benedict is saying is, you know, it's sort of keep each other in your line of vision. Right? is that, you know, I know people complain about Zoom, and I do my own fair share of it because I'm a troll in terms of technology. But it is one of the ways that we are able to stay close. And a younger colleague of mine, I was going a little bit of a lament about Zooming, and he said, this enables things to happen that would not have happened 25 years ago. We would have been in this isolation, and we would, you know, the only thing you could do is call and talk to on the phone to your family and to your friends. And so it goes back to the intentionality thing. Mm-hmm. We're going to draw close. We're going to have to figure out how to do it and stop complaining about it. Make use of the tools. You know, this beast that we have in front of us can be tamed and made to be helpful to us. Mm-hmm. There are no restrictions to practicing virtue in small ways and in grand ways. And most often the most effective are the small ways. And, you know, and then for people who are believers, I mean, you know, returning to the gospel and realizing that the presence of God is not all sweetness and light. It is that in the midst of suffering and pain, there is God. In the midst of the need for healing, there is Jesus. Benedict was very wise, is that we are not going to go forward anywhere until we really understand and take to heart what the gospel has to say.
Yeah, and in times of stress, ramping it up even. Times of difficult times. So speaking about drawing close, if we could just go back to that for a second, drawing close. Community is one of the things that you've mentioned, that you've written about. And I wonder if you could just give us an idea how you have practiced community. And what I'm thinking about during the pandemic, we're talking, what I'm thinking about in particular is a former presenter of ours had said one time, think about this past year, that we're only spending time, a lot of us are only spending time with people that we deem safe, right? And even then we're masked, so we can't see each other's smiles and the way our eyes move with our mouth, and, you know, the whole human experience. So what are ways that you have engaged in community through this past year, once you got past the complaining part?
I live in a condominium, and so the immediate circle are people in this who live here. We have homes here as well. I'm pretty introverted, and so being by myself is not necessarily a bad thing, except that point of being alone where I become spooky. I think I've also been attentive to the fact that there are people here that don't have regular social contact. And so while my preference might be is to stay in with a good book, watch a show on TV, is to go down to what's called the garden room where we can be spaced out and to have a conversation with a handful of people who really are looking for that. Mm-hmm. So if you're talking about my personal thing, it's pushing me beyond my preferences, is not being content, well, I can get by, you know, this or that. I have been more aware of the privilege that I have of teaching online. So I'm doing some writing workshops online. And that helps me both through a retreat center. And then I'm working on a project at Collegeville with a colleague. And we get, are meeting regularly with groups of people. And I think, you know, probably before all this happened, I would have taken all that for granted. And so what I'm learning is that I need to put myself out there. I think I might be a better community member after this than I was before it. I was lazy and took things for granted and was content. And now I'm realizing that it's not all, I hate to say that at this age, but it's not all about me. And that my preferences, well, I need to respect them. They cannot be governing how I reach out and am present to other people who are looking for different ways of being present. So it's a work in progress for me. I think that I've always been a Sunday worship person. I mean, it is integral to who I am. And I have not been in a church except to bury my brother-in-law this summer. And I realize that the absence of that physical gathering is very significant for me. There's a loneliness there that that I won't take for granted, you know, because I don't go to church and I don't dominate the coffee hour and try to meet 10 new people every Sunday. I don't do this. That's not the way I am. But there is something about being in that circle of people that I am going to be far more aware of as a result of this time of exile. So maybe what one of the things we're called to do during this is to re-examine that. You know, we all talk, you know, I'm a good talker about community. I've written some brilliant things about community and some poems that would make grown men weep, as they say. But I'm going to be paying, I think that I need to pay attention to what I do, how I do it, how I am a part of community. And I'm not, you know, it's not going to be, it's not going to be 180 degree turn, but it's going to be a turn. Because if this has taught me anything, it is that this level of isolation and caution and distance is not healthy for us. It is not healthy for us as individuals. It's not healthy for us as whatever configuring of community we're talking about.
Well, and I think, you know, what you're talking about, this is part of the creative potential, right? Mm-hmm. That, and I've been thinking a lot about what sort of things that we've learned during the pandemic do we want to be sure to carry forward with us once things settle down? I'm curious whether or not you think there is such a thing as normal, you know, that we're going to, you know, a lot of times people will say, oh, I can't wait till things get back to normal. When are things going to be normal again?
Well, here's how I would come down in that. I think longing for normal is dangerous because normal's gone forever. And what we're going to do, what lies before us, is creating I'm sort of a hypocrite, but a new normal. We are in the process of recreating, and not recapturing what was past, of recreating what will be. And so, I think that routines have changed and practices have changed. People have learned to gather in different organizations and in different ways. Mm-hmm. And so that we are called to recreate things that are new, that we have, you know, I don't know if Benedict said this or one of my Benedictine mentors said this, but we learn from experience, we learn from the past, and we learn from our mistakes. And that pool of learning has to be present to us as we create what is coming going to be next. A part of that is also, this probably is personal, but I do think it is part of the larger social learning, is, and it's certainly part of a larger Christian tradition, is that all things are passing away. You know, when I talk about the loss of our myth of invincibility, that was foolishness. Nobody is invincible. No country is invincible. No community is invincible. And so it doesn't mean living in a tentative way. But, you know, when people say, well, if we don't do it this way, I'm not being part of this. Well, what is this way, right? I mean, what are we trying to do? You know, where does virtue lead us? What are we, who are we called to be in terms of our best selves, our better angels? I think that's, if there is a new normal, it's that fluidity and that flexibility and that willingness to be far more adaptable and responsive than we had come to be.
Wow. Which takes some formation, which takes the listening that you were talking about, the attentiveness. And speak, if you would, please, a little bit to this conversion of life about always beginning again.
It's a Benedictine wisdom saying. I used to say it was that St. Benedict said it, and it's not. It's part of the larger tradition. The first time I heard it, I thought I had come home. I mean, I was raised to believe that perfection was our goal, and that if you really were on the path of perfection, you didn't trip, stumble, and fall. You kept progression, right? And the thing is the recognition that, you know, we do some things and they succeed. We try some things and they fail. As one old monk told a seeker, they asked him what was his secret to his spiritual life. And he said several times, I fall down and I get up. Fall down and I get up. I fall down and I get up. And so, we're going to make mistakes, right? And we're going to have some false starts and some misstarts, some pratfalls. But we began again. We began again because we're called, we're called forward by virtue. We're called forward by our belief that God's grace and God's goodness triumphs ultimately. We don't know when, but it will. We don't give ourselves over to despair. That, when we started talking this conversation of framing the world in these dark Eastern European tones, that I remember my grandmother and my father were immigrants, and listening to them have a conversation, you would think that the end was near. I mean, this had a way of looking at the world. Well, it seems to me that one of the reasons that Benedictine vision of life has had such an impact is that it's a queer alternative to that, is that it doesn't sugarcoat it and it doesn't make it soft and sweet, but it does say we began again, and we began again confident that we do not do this alone, either in terms of our fellows or of God's grace, and that we make progress, even as we fall down, and as we get up, and as you go forward again.
So as you're talking about it, I'm thinking, on an individual level, that's easy to understand but on a collective level, it's the same thing, and how difficult that is. To begin again and begin again.
Well, and here's, and the complicating factor for us as individuals, but for as organizations and as communities, as groups, is that, and especially as size grows, it takes more time, right? It takes more time because we have to listen to one another. We have to really understand. We have to move through the heat of our passions and our absolute convictions that this is the way it should be, to a place where we realize that there may be other ways of looking at something and moving towards it. And perhaps what this crisis has taught us is that that is not time wasted. I've worked with a lot of organizations who are in trouble, and you'd say, well, you need to spend time talking about what's at the core of who you are as a group and what you want to accomplish, what your mission is, vision, your values. And, you know, too often I'd run into, well, yeah, but that's going to take a lot of time. Let's come up with some rules. Or let's come up with a new manual, policy manual. No, it's going to take time of just talking and listening. Again, false starts, misunderstandings, having to make amends, having to reconcile. There's no other shortcut. There is no shortcut on this. There is no shortcut. We can wait for a charismatic leader. We can wait for someone to do it for us. We'll wait a long time. And sometimes we wait for that person, they come along and it's not what we want. It is not, you know, the person on the white horse is not the savior. We are the ones we've been waiting for.
We are the ones we've been waiting for. At this time, I would love if we would get some comments from you, the participants, questions, comments. And we have one to start with here from Greg Spofford. He's wondering, Vic, if you could say a little bit more about your project at St. John's. I think, is he talking about the...
Oh, the ministry project.
Okay.
I've been working on a project at St. John's for about, I think we're going into our third year of developing and sustaining healthy ministerial workplaces. And, you know, some of the things we're talking about tonight are applicable to that. I mean, I don't know if I would paint the situation in crisis, but there are some really deep concerns that the sort of, you know, awareness and listening and experimentation and beginning again and again is really, really critical. And it's been wonderful for me at this point in my life and career to be with people who take that challenge seriously and who are working positively, who are trying to lean in together to find their way through.
Wonderful. So go ahead and if you want to put your questions in through the chat function and then I can read them to Vic. If you want to talk, you can click on the raise hand function. Oh, I guess, let's see. I thought I had one there. You can click on the raise hand function and then I can unmute your or click a little thing here that will let you unmute your microphone so you can say your comment or question, but go ahead and keep sending those in. I wanted to ask you, you know, a lot of what I think about and what I've thought about in this past year has had to do with self-care. How do we care for ourselves in such a way that we allow that time, that we allow that discernment process, that listening, that attending to what we're hearing and seeing? And I'm wondering, Vic, if you have specific practices that nourish your own life in that way, if you could speak to some of those.
I'm really very fortunate and grateful that I like to write. And that for the last 35 years, poetry has been the primary way in which I have written apart from the professional things I might've had to do. And I have found that working on a poem and really trying to move, you know, sort of the jumble of emotions and feelings and doubts and anxieties, to move from that to somewhere, so being able to find a path through that. I have a friend of mine that talks about the thicket, that emotional thicket, and to find a path through the thicket imposed by this time, imposed by state of life, imposed about my worries about the larger world of which I'm a part. And so that's an opportunity for me, because writing is a sorting out the jumble. Right? There's just tons of things that we think about every day, but to go from your head to the keyboard or to pen and paper, you have to make some decisions. You know, what am I trying to say? What is nagging at me? What is poking at me? What is calling me forth? is there a light in this that I'm missing? You know, and that even sometimes I'll go back to a dark poem. And after I get over being frightened by it, I began to rework it and revise it. And I'm a pretty radical reviser. I wouldn't say every time, but very often I find that vein of light in it, that's what I'm working towards. Mm. Is that why I can be filled with bombast? I think I'm a pretty optimistic person. I want to believe in the goodness of humanity and that good triumphs over evil and that we will one day all work together and be sisters and brothers. If that's naive, I like that part of my naivete because it balances sort of the ponderous things that go on inside of me as I worry about the future for my four grandsons who I adore. Right, and the future of this earth that I will be leaving behind, and the peoples and the potentials of peoples to live in a more prosperous and just and beautiful environment. So, writing has been for me an enduring gift that I mean, I've always appreciated it, but during these days, it has really been a companion, a good companion for me. Mm. And, you know, I'm in a writing group, and so I'm with other writers, and, you know, that helps as well to make that work the way it should work.
And for you, it's poetry more than essays, right?
Yes.
Am I correct? Okay.
Right.
And I remember you said to me once, Vic, you said that you challenged yourself to write one poem a day. How long ago was that?
I probably did that for 20 years. You know, I'm picking it up again. I haven't been slugging off, but I have been revising almost every day for the last several months, some things. But I'm going to, Lent has been always, I've always taken the challenge of Lent as trying to take a reading from Lent or from working with a particular book. I'm working with a wonderful book called Word by Word by Marilyn Chandler. I'm trying to compose something every day. Mm. And, you know, to be truthful, some of it is a lot of what I do in that discipline is stuff that, you know, needs to be burned upon my death. But it is the practice, right? It is the practice. It's meditative. It's focused. It moves from sort of, oh yeah, all this stuff is going on, to something that is concrete and specific.
Wonderful. We have a comment from Susan Zabel. She says, I love your comments about the dwelling in the shadows of the Eastern European mindset. Coming from that same background, I know exactly what you are saying, and the Benedictine way is a wonderful antidote for that. Thanks for sharing that. I can really relate.
There should be a group for us to that person. There should be a group for us for ongoing healing.
Yeah. Gary Bolhauer says, perhaps one of the benefits of this time of pandemic is our requirement to live more simply, more close to our central relationships, less distracted by the myriad things that took so much of our energy before this time. Might this time help us become more simple and focused on what is most important?
I like that. I think that is part of the winnowing process. You know, and you said, Don said about going back to normal. I don't know if I'd want to go back to the, I mean, even though I'm semi-retired, you know, I have a pretty busy life, and I don't think I want to go back to that in the same sort of way. I want to make some choices about what I'm going to do. And again, that's privilege talking, right? I can do that. But I've listened to my adult children talk about their life as family, and some interesting things have happened because they've made some choices about how they're going to be family and how they're going to spend time together and what they're going to choose to do and not do. And I think that if that can be one of the lessons that this time of crisis has taught us. It's a very good lesson. We live in the midst of clutter. You know, we're inundated every day with the noise talked about, with the clutter of news and disaster and impending disaster, and it might be a disaster. And there was a disaster 10 years ago. If you forgot about it, we'll remind you of it. And it just becomes ponderous. You just are, you know, you get round-shouldered carrying on your back. Mm-hmm. And I think simplicity says, you know, what is the next step that I'm going to take? How am I going to be? You know, and I think the first step we take is, how am I going to be in my relationships? How am I going to cultivate the relationships that I have? I know that I've always tried to be intentional about the important relationships, but I really am real intentional. I don't have a big circle, so it's pretty easy for me to do. But you get sloppy about it. You know, I'll call my friend, or I'll call my brother, and, you know, 3 months goes by, and I'm far more aware that I can't do that anymore. I want to be true, because that's because of the type of life that I think I want to be living as a result of this experience.
One of the things that I've noticed, and I don't think it's because I live in Duluth and the wilderness that I've come to experience as a city, but the people spending time out of doors, we were kind of pushed out of doors at the beginning in order to be safe, right? And it happened to coincide with the season, you know, which helped. But I've seen people doing things outside, even in the dead of winter, that I haven't seen before. And so... and I think all of that kind of coincides with a lot of the climate events we've been experiencing in the past year. There's this renewed appreciation of nature, you know, and God's first Bible, right?
Yeah.
I have a question. Does Vic have published poetry available to us? If you could speak to that, Vic.
Amazon.com put my boys through college. I mean, that's what I had to say. I do collections from time to time, and do them through Amazon's publishing arm, mostly as part of my discipline. Again, is that, you know, I gather a bundle of poems, and then I sit down with them and I sort and winnow, and, you know, from a stack of 100 or so, 150 the last time, I ended up with 50. That and then I have some critics, and those were winnowed, and I had to reduce some other ones to have a nice little compact book. So I have some collections out there of poems, and am currently working on another volume. So yes, but they're all on Amazon.
So if people go to Amazon and just search for you, they'll find your poetry. Yeah. Wonderful. I'm sorry. Were you going to say something?
No.
Oh, I thought, okay. We have another comment from Celeste. Two women I met at Victor's poetry workshop at Scholastica. Oh. Yes. And I meet monthly to write poems. It has been via Zoom, but still so enriching and inspiring, especially now during this time of seclusion. Isn't that wonderful?
That's great. That is great to hear. Yep. One of the delightful parts of my life now is working with writers. You know, I don't so much teach writing as much as convene writers and help them, in a sense, recognize their gifts and develop them, of course, but become so that they can become companions with one another. And Celeste, thank you for bearing testimony to that.
Yes, that's wonderful. Well, I'm aware of the time. I just want to thank everyone for being with us tonight. This has been a wonderful and rich conversation with you, Vic. I want to let you all know that our next Benedictine conversation, the registration is on the webpage and goes out in our weekly email, will be with Parker Palmer on March 16th. And then Vic, thank you, Vic. This has been absolutely wonderful. And I'm excited about this next publication that's coming out. I know I got to see a little sneak preview of it, and it's absolutely beautiful. So I'm hoping you might be convinced to share one of your poems with us tonight, Vic.
Thank you. I would be delighted to it. There are very few writers who need to be asked twice to read their stuff. So when I was thinking about this, because Dawn did ask if I would consider doing that, I had one that was a pretty poem, nature poem. Nature has been one of my main teachers in life. But then I have, the poem I'm going to read is called Road to Damascus. And it originated as a poem for a colleague, dear friend of mine, who was leaving a position. And it was a difficult leave taking. And it was somewhat traumatic in different ways. And so I wrote this poem for him. And so as I was thinking about this today, I came across Road to Damascus. And I thought, you know, this is probably more appropriate to the conversation that Don and I will have. And that even though you now know the backstory of this, as I'm reading this, I am thinking about this time of crisis. And the seriousness of it and the demands of it, but it's that small vein of light in it that I hope is what you would take away from its hearing. So I offer this to you, and thank you for listening and allowing me to sort of think aloud with you. Road to Damascus. Sometimes when change comes, whether by choice or crisis, it comes in a flurry of turmoil. What once was comfortable no longer offers a resting place. The time to leave arrives, and yet the way forward seems as treacherous as an unmapped swamp. At the start, you look ahead with few signs you will arrive unharmed and whole. Despite all your good planning, even your best self may whisper how risk infects change, stirring vigilance and fear lest rash choices spell doom. Few arrive at their destination unbandaged or unbruised. Yet when they lay their eyes on the place they know is their destiny's homestead, they do not look back at the terrain they covered, but forward, always forward, to what lies ahead.
Wow. Beautiful. Thank you, Vic.
Pleasure.
Thank you. And on behalf of the Sisters of St. Scholastica and the Center for Spirituality and Enrichment, I wish you all a blessed Lent and hope to see you back next month. Thank you.